If you have your Bibles then, we'll ask you to turn to the book of the Song of Solomon. Song of Solomon, chapter 5, and we're going to begin reading in verse 6. Song of Solomon, chapter 5, beginning in verse 6. The Bible says, I opened to my beloved, but my beloved had withdrawn himself and was gone. My soul failed when he spake. I sought him, but I could not find him. I called him, but he gave me no answer. The watchmen that went about the city found me. They smote me, they wounded me, and the keepers of the walls took away my veil from me. I charge you, O daughters of Jerusalem, if you find my beloved, that you tell him that I am sick of love. What is thy beloved more than another beloved? O thou fairest among women, what is beloved more than another beloved, that thou doest so charge us? My beloved is white and ruddy, the chiefest among 10,000. His head is as the most fine gold, his locks are bushy and black as raven, his eyes are as the eyes of doves, by the rivers of waters, washed with milk and fitly set. His cheeks are as a bed of spices, as sweet flowers. His lips like lilies, dropping sweet smelling myrrh. His hands are as gold rings set with beryl. His belly as a bright ivory overlaid with sapphire. His legs are as pillars of marble set upon sockets of fine gold. His countenance is as Lebanon, excellent as the cedars. His mouth is most sweet, yea, he is altogether lovely. This is my beloved, and this is my friend, O daughters of Jerusalem. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for your many blessings. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity tonight to look in on your word one more time this side of eternity. We praise you for your word, and we praise you for your continuance, just always being with us and near us, irregardless of the situation. Lord, we pray that you would help your people that are here tonight. God knows that the only help lies within you. Lord, we pray for the lost, that you might save them. Lord, that you might speak life, that you might bring them to salvation even tonight. Lord God, we pray that we would be fitly used of you. We pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now, I'll be preaching tonight on, I want to tell you about my friend. Now, a lot of people today don't even know what a real friend is. They have so-called friends, but a friend is a priceless commodity. Most of what we esteem friends, especially when we're young, are nothing more than good time friends. Friends that are there when the going is good and they're gone when the going gets bad. But a true friend is so much better than that. As Solomon is writing, he praises, and the whole Song of Solomon is really a love sonnet from Israel to God, and back and forth, and about their relationship. In verse 6 he says, I opened to my beloved, but my beloved had withdrawn himself. Now, as the psalmist is writing, he describes a condition that, if we'd be honest, every one of us has been in when we cried out to the Lord and there was no response. When we cried out and there was no answer. When it was empty and dry and nothing happening, every one of us, if we'd be honest, have experienced that. And that's what the writer here was experiencing. He cried out to the Lord, and there was emptiness about him. And if you haven't had that, you will. And the reason why is the sin in our lives. When we have sin in our life, and it can be simply not being prepared to be plugged in. You know what? We live in a day and age today where most of us don't even make adequate preparation to be in the house of God. We have so much going on outside this place that we don't have the time to pray as we should. We don't
You don't have time to pray for me. I don't have time to pray for you. And the end result is this: we get here and we don't hear from God. Now, the psalmist was in that situation. He cried out, just as empty as it could be. And many of us, all of us, go through that from time to time. And so we find that as he began to write this, it ought to be something every one of us could identify with. I opened to my beloved, but my beloved had withdrawn himself and was gone. My soul failed when he spake. I saw him, but I could not find him. Now, let me say this. If you have a frame of mind to seek the Master, seek him. Now, all the redeemed can seek the Lord. And all the redeemed have situated. You remember David? I think David is probably the best example, because the Bible says David was a man after God's own heart, that understood the things of God, understood the ways of God, yet and still he has this adulterous relationship with Bathsheba. It leads to the murder of Uriah the Hittite. And then when it's all said and done, and the preacher comes his way and gives him a good figure to sermon, and he still don't get it. And you know why he don't get it? Because he's far from God. So finally the prophet said, "Thou art the man." He had to bring it down to very base terms and says, "It's your fault, David. This is your situation. And on top of that, the child's going to die." See, that's the situation. If we don't take care of it here, that's the situation it'll lead to. And so we see that the writer was very scared about it. Now, it thrills my heart in the fact that the writer is upset. You know, we live in a day and age today where we don't hear from God. We really don't even get upset about it. Really don't. You know what I have found through nearly 25 years of preaching is it's always someone else's fault. And when I was on that side of the pew, it was the preacher's fault. And now that I'm on this side of the pulpit, I want to blame everybody out here. And that's just being honest, right? It's never my fault. You know what? This psalmist, he took ownership of it, didn't he? He said, "You know what? This is my fault. This is my problem." You know what? I believe our spiritual conditions would improve if we could just say, "Hey, it's my fault." Because I know this, it ain't God's fault. And so we see that the psalmist had a very good understanding of his relationship with the Lord. Now notice verse 7. "The watchman that went about the city found me." Now if you write in your Bible, underline that one, because I want you to get the full situation, because God withdrew his presence, and when God withdrew his presence, then the enemy found him. Pretty blatant, ain't it? Pretty obvious. You know what? If God withdraw his presence from you, you're fair game. Yeah. Remember when the Lord God Almighty said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job?" Yeah. And remember the devil's response, "You bumped the hedge about him." And in the same situation here, as soon as the presence of God was gone, the enemy came. And in our lives, if we have sin, open, abject sin in our life, and in response to that, the presence of the Lord leaves us. Yes, we're open game. We're fair game for the enemy. In fact, if church discipline teaches anything, it teaches that. What did he say in 1 Corinthians 5? He said, "Set that one out from among you for the destruction of the flesh, so that he might be saved in that day," right? And so we see that when this hedge of protection is removed, we're fair game. And that's what happens in verse 7. "The watchmen that went about the city found me. They smote me and they wounded me. The keepers of the wall took away my veil from me. I charge you, O God." And one more thing before leaving verse 7, when he says it took his veil from him.
Now remember, that is in the days of Jerusalem. That's the day of the wall. And in that time, the men covered their head to pray as well. So now he's not equipped anymore. Men, ladies, you ever felt like you weren't equipped to pray?
Yeah,
I have.
Yeah.
And now that's the situation. This man, he no longer equipped to pray. And he very distraught about the situation. Verse 8. I charge you, O daughters of Jerusalem, if you find my beloved, that you tell him that I am sick of love sick. In other words, he's saying, you listen, if you see my love, if you, you know what that really says? Listen, you pray for me. Listen, when you see me love sick, you pray for me. When you see me down and out, and I'm at the bottom of the barrel, you pray for me. Don't you go around and be wagging your tongue about me and running me down to the neighbor. You get on your knees before God and you pray for me. You know, that's what we need to do. And listen, when you see somebody doing something that you may not think is exactly the way that you would do it, you know what? What you need to do is get on your face before God and pray for that individual if you're really concerned. Now, if all you're doing is gossiping, then forget about it.
Yeah.
Right? And so we see that this individual was heart sick because the Lord had left him, and he desired to be close to him again. Verse 9. What is my beloved more than another beloved? In other words, why is he better? Why is this person, oh, thou fairest among women? What is thy beloved more than another beloved that thou hast so that thou doest so charge us? My beloved is white and ruddy and chiefest among 10,000. Now the next several verses, the writer describes the person, the Lord God, and the love, why he loves him. You know, have you ever thought about trying to sit down and describe how much you love God and why you love him? That's his attempt at this. Have you ever sat down and thought about listing how good he's been to you? You know, I'm 48, closer to 49 now, and I never, ever went to bed. I was just thinking about this the other day, that I didn't have a cover to put over me if I wanted it, and a pillow. You know, that's pretty good, ain't it? When you read of prophets that their pillow was a stone, I've always had a nice pillow. And you know what? I've always had something to eat. It might not have been what I wanted, but I always had something to eat, right? And the Lord's good to us, and we ought to give Him praise. And so as he's beginning to try to write down the ideas of how that he loved the Lord, he says, my beloved is white and ruddy, and that means literally white and red or comely, the chiefest among 10,000. His head is of the most fine gold. His locks are bushy and black as a raven. His eyes are as the eyes of doves, and the rivers of waters washed with milk and fitly set. His cheeks are as a bed of spices, as sweet flowers. His lips like lilies, drooping sweet-smelling myrrh. His hands are as gold rings set with beryl. His belly is bright ivory overlaid with sapphire. His legs are as pillars of marble, set upon sockets of fine gold. His countenance is as Lebanon, excellent as the cedars. His mouth is sweet, yea, it is altogether lovely. This is my beloved. This is my friend. Now, when you begin to think of friends, the person of the Lord Jesus Christ is the very best friend you'll ever have.
Now,
the very best friend that I have in this life is God. But I got a better one, and she's got a better one than me. The very best friend you ever, because you know what? He won't fail you. He will always be. Now, sometimes because of our carnal flesh, we get sin in our life, and you know what? He's going to leave you then. That's what's wrong with this fellow. And the reason the Lord withdrew himself is because of the sin in his life. And he'll, but you know what? If we're in the will of God and we found his will, he will be with us, and it doesn't matter whatever. All the other stuff that's going on around us and about us, it really doesn't matter because the Lord is with us. And you know what? We need to get back to the simplicity of that. If the Lord is with us, the Bible says, who can be against us? So, why can we not rejoice in that? What wonderful, wonderful friend that we have. A wholesome, wonderful friend that does all things for us in a perfect and in a wonderful way. Go with me to Proverbs. And again, I'm just reading a couple of things to you because in the modern day, people don't understand what a friend is. Many of the people that I thought I was friends with when I was in school, high school, they don't want nothing to do with me no more. And the reason why I found out is this, they were never really my friends. We live in a day and age today where we can't draw that line between an acquaintance and a friend. Now, I'm going to give you one benchmark for a friend tonight, and you always remember this. Does it drive you toward Christ or away from Him?
Yeah.
Now, if the individual drives you toward Christ, you found a friend. And if the individual drives you away from the things of Christ, he is not your friend. Now, he may present as a friend, and he may give you lots of things and have money and have a nice car and have a nice truck and do all these wonderful things for you, but if they take you from Christ, they are not your friend. A friend will drive you toward Christ every time. And certainly, we as the Lord's people need to make that our benchmark. Proverbs 17, verse 17. Proverbs 17, in verse 17, the Bible says, "A friend loveth at all times. A brother is born for adversity. A friend loveth at all times." Now you think about Job's friends. Do you think they met the definition? A friend loveth at all times. When it's good news, when it's bad news, when you make decisions that they accept or they make decisions they reject, a friend loveth at all times. Now, with that said, that doesn't mean they tell you everything is okay when you have sin in your life, because we'll find this is another benchmark of a friend. They'll tell you the truth. You know, sometimes truth is hard to tell. When my wife or my older daughter comes up and says, "How's this dress look?" You've done been set up. Does that make sense? What are you going to say? You know, the best thing to do is tell the truth. After 30 years of marriage, sometimes asking a question, "What do you think about it?" But a friend will tell you the truth. A friend will tell you the truth. And so, when we begin to think of friends, you need to evaluate, are they giving you truthfulness or are they giving you a lie? Now, I want to say one other thing about a friend in Proverbs 27, just a little further over. Proverbs 27 and verse 9. Proverbs 27 and verse 9. The Bible says, "Ointment and perfume rejoice the heart, so doeth the sweetness of a friend by hearty counsel." By hearty counsel, by brass counsel, by telling you that's how it is. A good, strong counsel. Somebody say, "Larry, I wouldn't do that. It might not be what I want to hear, but it's good, hearty counsel."
that make sense? Well, what I found in the modern day is people want to hear what they want to hear. When they ask, you know, this is what I told my students one day. I said, don't ask me what I think unless you really want to know. Because we ought to be a truthful people. Hearty counsel is the good and the bad. When it's not, a friend will be honest, even to the point of hurting. That's why things like this, when somebody tells me, do you think I'm saved? And I've had people say that to me. I'll just say, I don't know. That's good hearty counsel. Everybody knows the boy sat there for about 2 years. And every service, every other service, he wanted me to tell him he was saved. You know what? I can't do that. You know why? Because it's not hearty counsel. Did I like the man? Yeah, he had a lot of issues, but I liked him. But at the same time, I wouldn't have been a friend if I'd say, oh yeah, man, you're in good shape. But there's some that would. Right? And so we see then as the Lord's people, when we begin to think about a friend as of the person of Christ, honesty is the very benchmark of what friendship should be measured. It is the very element of what friendship's about. Now, we could go all night thinking about friends that have been friends and friends that were not necessarily really friends after all. But I think always the best thing is just to look to the Bible for examples. In the Gospel of John chapter 11, the story of Lazarus. The Gospel of John chapter 11, in verse 11, John 11, 11, the Bible says, these things said he, and after that he saith unto them, our friend Lazarus sleepeth. Isn't it a wonderful, wonderful thing that he noted that Lazarus was a friend? You know, if the Lord doesn't return, every one of us are looking death eye to eye on a daily basis. Now, we don't like to think about it, and I'm past middle age now, and Brother Ashley, I think he's in his 30s, and Adam's in his 20s. And by numeric value, I'm closer than y'all are. But the truth is, we just don't know. Right? The truth is we just don't know. And when death approaches, isn't it a wonderful thing to have a friend? Because the Lord Jesus says, our friend Lazarus. You know, when death comes my way, having a friend as Jesus is going to be a wonderful thing. A friend that extends beyond the present and the now. A friend that goes past what the walks of this life is about. Goes and extends beyond. Our friend Lazarus sleepeth, but I go that I may awake him out of sleep. Then said his disciples, Lord, if he sleep, he shall do well. Howbeit, Jesus spake of his death, but they thought that he'd spoken of taking a rest and sleep. Now, you can tell that the apostles were the first Baptists because they just didn't get it. They operated at just the topsoil level. They never dug very deep. They thought, oh, well, man, he's doing good. Get him a good rest. But, you know, the Lord Jesus had to say plainly, Lazarus is dead. You know, a good friend will always tell you plainly. They won't paint it and make it pretty. They'll just say, no, that's not the way it is. I've had friends and lots of other church groups, and as kindly as I could tell them, I had to tell them the truth. Right? Don't be confrontational about it. But me telling them that everything is fine will do them no good. And so he finally had to tell them very plainly, Lazarus is dead. He's dead. And he says, and I'm glad for your sakes that I wasn't there. And why was that? He wanted his friend Lazarus to die? No, but he wanted all those individuals to see him as God in the flesh. And the way that he caused that to happen was to say very triumphantly, Lazarus, come forth! And he did. As the Bible says, he came out bound hand and foot, but he followed the command of Jesus. Man, what a friend is that. What a glorious, wonderful friend. When time comes to leave this place, to have the friend, you know what? It's always good if you're going somewhere to know somebody that's already been there before. And you know what? When death comes my way, I know someone that's already been there before, and he's got victory over it, the Bible says. And you know what? So why stress about it when you have a friend like that? Now, the truth is this. Is many that call him friend probably ain't. Many that call him friend probably ain't. Now, I want you to drop down to verse 43 with me. John 11, verse 43. And when he had thus spoken, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus! Come forth! And he that was dead came forth bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was bound about with a napkin. And Jesus saith unto them, Loose him and let him go. And many of the Jews which had come to Mary and had seen these things which Jesus did believed on him. Now, can you get the full picture? You talk about a friend. You know what? When Jesus says something, it's going to happen. That's why this jargon of Jesus is wanting to save you if you let him. Listen, that's trash. Because listen, whatever, you follow the word of God, and anytime Jesus ever wanted something, you know what? It happened. You know what? If he has victory over death, can you imagine? He was all bound up and wound up the way Jews did it like this. And Jesus said, come forth. So he came out like this. He obeyed the command even though he was tied up and wound up in a big sheet. You know, that's the kind of friend to have. That's the kind of friend to have. One that's victorious over death. Very important that you know Jesus. The thought of leaving this place without knowing the Lord Jesus is really beyond my comprehension, because I would be very wary of it. Go a little further over, John chapter 12, in the very first verse. Then Jesus, 6 days before the Passover, this was a week before the crucifixion, came to Bethany, where Lazarus, which had been dead, when he raised from the dead, there they made him a supper, and Martha served, but Lazarus was one of them that sat at the table with him. Now, can you imagine this? It's just probably a short time later, now it's a week before the crucifixion, Lazarus is still living. He's there with his sister. They fix him a big meal. This is where Martha got all bent out of shape about serving. You know what? It's a wonderful thing to serve. In fact, if you will follow Acts 13, that was Paul's heart, was to serve. But listen, if you're doing it to be seen, you might well stop it. And I'm afraid sometimes that was Martha's situation. And we find that they're rejoicing, they're having a time. And then notice what it says in verse 3. And Mary then took Mary a pound of ointment of spikenard, very costly, and anointed the feet of Jesus and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the odor of the ointment. Now, that's what friends do. That it moves you to a higher level of service. You know why? You know why sometimes the Lord challenges us, such as quitting jobs that get in the way?
He wants you to know how much you love Christ. He really does. Now, you think you know how much you love Him, but you don't. Not really. And He wants you to know. He wants you to be aware of your level of service, your level of interest in the things of God, your level of concern. He wants you to understand that in about yourself. And then in verse 4, we're not going to read it because of time's sake, but we find that Judas Iscariot gets very bent out of shape over the fact that the costly ointment was wasted as he saw it. And let me say this, nothing's ever wasted on Christ. If you spend $1 million, it's never wasted. It's never wasted because the Lord will bless it and amplify it if you do it for the right reasons. Now, drop down to verse 9 with me. Much people of the Jews therefore knew that he was there, meaning Christ was at Lazarus' house. And they came not for Jesus' sake only, but that they might see Lazarus also, whom he had raised from the dead. But the chief priests consulted that they might put Lazarus also to death, because that by reason of him many Jews went away and believed on Jesus. Now, did you get that? This friendship that Lazarus had with Jesus was threatening. See, people are okay with you being friends to Jesus as long as you don't take it too far. As long as you don't get too crazy and then out of shape about it, they're okay with it. But when it comes down and begins to impact your daily life and your work and your money, they're going to say, chill out. Listen, you've taken this thing too far. But see, Lazarus was taking it to the point of death. And you know why? He knew Jesus had power over death. So that's the kind of friend to have. That's the kind of friend I want, is someone that has the unbelievable power to do what he will. That is the friend, and that's the friendship that these two men had. Go with me to the book of James. James chapter 2. Now, a lot of people don't like the little epistle of James because it talks so much about works. And the reason they don't like it is because it fully says that if you don't do works, you're lost. And people don't like that. Baptist people particularly don't like that. But you know what? It's true. And if what you have from Christ don't move you to good works, then you probably are still lost. James chapter 2. James chapter 2 and verse 21. James chapter 2 and verse 21. The Bible says, was not Abraham our father justified by works when he offered Isaac his son upon the altar? Now, you know, that's a bitter pill for a lot of people to swallow, because it does say, was he not justified by works? But see, this was the thing. His faith caused those works to happen. His faith, yes, he was just before men, because he believed God. If you don't believe that, remember what right before they went up the hill, he looked at them servants and said, me and the lad's going to go worship yonder. And then we will come again. And he even when he said that, he knew God said, slay that boy, take his life. And he even then said, me and him are going to go worship, and then we're going to come again. And so we see he had the faith, and it caused the works to happen in his life. And if you don't have works that's a result of the faith, probably you've never been born again to start with. Works are critically important.
People don't like to talk about him. See, that's the problem today, is a lot of so-called Baptists, that all they want is a little sinner's prayer and you to do something stupid, and then you can live like hell the rest of your life. And when you die, some kind of well-meaning preacher is going to say, "Well, I remember when he was 12 years old." Well, so what? Where's his works? Where's his works? And most of the time it's this. Their works show exactly who they were. They really do.
Yeah. Mm.
And so we see then that Abraham was the kind of man that backed up his faith with works. Verse 22, "Seest thou not that faith wrought his works?" Exactly what I said. "Seest thou not that his faith wrought or caused his works to happen? By works was faith made perfect or complete or evident or obvious. His works showed his faith. And the scripture was fulfilled which saith, Abraham believed God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God." Now, you talk about a wonderful, marvelous friend, a friend of God. Now, how did Abraham get this position? Because he did what God told him to do. That's how he was God. He was friend to God. When he was down in the Ur of the Chaldees, God said, "Head out." And you know what? At 75 years old, he headed out. He left everything. The only thing he did that was stupid is he took Lot with him. But God took care of that problem too, didn't he? See, that's the kind of friend you want. If you don't have any other friends, you got one. If you know him. You know, good test of friendship. I've had some good friends over the years. Good preacher friends, good friends. This is a good test of a friendship. My friend that I've known the longest, we've been friends now almost 46 years. Me and Lynn Lemons is her married name. And you know how I can always tell when she calls, and sometimes it's literally 2 years. 2 years we don't speak. And as soon as she calls, I say, "Hey, Lynn," and she says, "Hey, Larry," and we pick up exactly where we were left off. And you know why? That's a good friendship. So what about your friendship with Christ? How close are you? You know what? If I needed something tonight, if I needed something physically, I believe I could go to Brother Ashley and say, "Listen, this is my situation, and I fully believe that he would help me." That's a friend. But can you imagine going to the magnificent God of all the universe and just laying your needs out before him? So that's a true friend. That's a true friend. All right. A word.